Okay, now this is a very interesting patient. I want my colleague to give you the PowerPoint presentation. Can you give the PowerPoint presentation? Can you move?
I'm presenting a case of severe mitral and aortic stenosis. A 29-year-old female, mother of 5-year-old child, with a history of acute rheumatic carditis in childhood, at 12 years of age in 2004, was diagnosed as severe rheumatic MS. Underwent first balloon mitral valvotomy at 12 years of age. She developed complaints of dyspnea during pregnancy at 24 years. So in 2017, she underwent second balloon mitral valvotomy at 6 months of gestation. Now she has recurrence of symptoms for the past 1 year. She is weighing 63 kg with a height of 146 centimeter. Her JVP is not elevated, doesn't have pedal edema. She has a loud S1 and opening snap with a mid-diastolic murmur, a loud mid-diastolic murmur at apex and a loud dissection systolic murmur in right upper sternal border. The X-ray shows mitralization of the left heart border, left atrial enlargement and mild pulmonary venous hypertension. This is the transesophageal echo showing the fixed PML and thickened AML and mitral valve area of 0.7 square centimeter. The Doppler gave a gradient of 33 by 21 at a heart rate of 90, severe MS. This is the 3D reconstruction view of mitral valve from both LA and LV sides, demonstrating the immobile PML and bicommissural fusion with severe subvalvar fusion also. The patient also had a bicuspid aortic valve with an area of 0.8 square centimeters, and the Doppler gave a gradient of 91 by 52, suggestive of severe AS, and this image is the 3D reconstruction of the aortic valve.
Mario and Alison, back to you from the other lab. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very well and see you as well.
Okay, so this is an interesting patient. This patient's second balloon mitral valvotomy, I remember I performed it when she was pregnant with around 6 to 7 months of pregnancy, where we had a complete radiation shield all around her abdomen and we completed the procedure in about 60 seconds of fluoroscopic time. At the time we just went in for some amount of dilatation in order to get the hemodynamics better, but we did not get a perfect valve opening. Assisting me is Dr. Pramod Sagar on my right side and Dr. Ashok on my left side. Both of them have been associated with me for quite a long time. We have got a femoral venous and femoral arterial access from the right groin, and what you are showing here is the hemodynamics. Hemodynamics, large screen, there is significant pulmonary hypertension. The hemodynamics, large screen. Hemodynamics, yeah. You can appreciate that the pulmonary artery pressure was almost 92 millimeters with a mean of 67 millimeters, quite a substantial pulmonary arterial hypertension. And the aortic pressure trace is showing a little bit of anacrotic notch. Increase the speed. You can see that anacrotic notch on the ascending aortic trace, indicating that there is fairly a significant aortic stenosis. Now I'm pulling back the catheter into the right ventricle. There is no pulmonary valve gradient. I'm now pulling back into the right atrium, and this is right atrial mean pressure of, show it in 10 scale. Right atrial mean pressure is somewhere around 7 millimeters of mercury. So now we are getting ready for a transseptal puncture. Show me fluorobeak. So we are getting ready for a standard transseptal puncture. Show the venous catheter below. Show above.
So while you're setting up for your transseptal, can I ask you a question about her aortic stenosis during her pregnancy? Did that cause How did you discern that mitral stenosis was the primary factor, and was there any consideration of aortic valve modulation then also?
Aortic valve at that time was having a pressure gradient of somewhere around 25 to 30 millimeters of mercury peak to peak, and it was not looking very significant at all. So we did not even cross the aortic valve during the last time. As I told you, it was a pregnancy state, so we did not do any left-sided study at all. It was primarily catheter that just went in from the right heart. We did the dilatation. She has a single SVC or bilateral SVC? I think bilateral superior vena cava. Okay. Yeah. So.
And how optimistic are you about the mitral valve now, a third valvuloplasty with subvalvular fusion? What do you think?
It may give suboptimal results, Alison, but it will help in postponing the mitral valve replacement surgery. You know, whenever there is a significant subvalvar fusion, the surgeon will tend to change the mitral valve. And so when he changes the mitral valve, this patient will get a change in the aortic valve as well. And so that will be like putting in a 29-year-old lady with two prosthetic valves. If I can delay by another, say, a few years, putting in a mechanical prosthetic valve, I'll be very happy about it. What is your thought process? I don't want perfection. I want some improvement in the hemodynamics so that I can avoid the prosthetic valve for a few more years.
Yes, certainly in a young female to avoid two valves would be great. Audience, any other ideas or comments?
I will tell you one story. This lady, after I did the balloon valvotomy during her pregnancy, she then subsequently delivered a very healthy child, and the child is fine. She was very curious that she wants to have another baby. And so she says, get me the valve dilated, and I want to go for my second child as well. So these are the realities in countries like ours.
You are not going to use ECMO retinine at all, do you?
Yeah, we don't. This is going to be a fluoro-guided septal puncture. I will show you how we normally do it. So now I'm coming into that sheath. I'm now, show me above. So now this patient incidentally has got bilateral superior vena cava. And so I'm not positioning the transeptal sheath within the mitral, in the left denominate vein. Now I have got the transeptal Mullins dilator. I am now facing somewhere around 3 o'clock. As I come down, I will place my pigtail in the non-coronary cusp. I am now coming down. I'm now giving, almost I am facing 5 o'clock. I don't know whether you are able to see my camera here, my hand. Okay, my hand, my clothes. No. Make 50% fluoro and 50% my hand.
Picture in picture.
Fluoro picture also. The hand, yeah, correct. Perfect. So now I'm coming down further. I want to come below the aortic root. I will just see what is the position on my RAO40 projection. In RAO40, I should be well anterior to the descending thoracic aorta, not hitting the posterior wall. It's quite anterior. Now I am making it a little go posterior. Okay. Now go to AP again. In AP, I am almost one vertebral space below the non-coronary cusp. Go to lateral. Full lateral. Okay. Now, table up. So now I want to puncture between the aortic root and the posterior wall of the left atrium. I am puncturing. Come to AP view. Fluorostore that and repeat it. So I'm puncturing between the middle of the aortic root and the posterior wall of the left atrium. So we are indenting the septum and I am introducing the needle. This is a standard BRK needle. Now come to. Not seeing good pictures. Let me see it. Can I see only the contrast? This is the left atrial pressures. I'm going to. So this is the left atrium, and I'm showing now the left atrial pressures. So the left atrial mean pressure is about 32 millimeters, 33 millimeters of mercury. Increase the speed. The patient is having substantial tachycardia. Can we give a little bit of metoprolol? Can you give 5 milligram metoprolol slowly over 5 minutes? There's a lot of sinus tachycardia. Probably the, she's very anxious because she's conscious now. So this is the left atrial pressure. It's almost around 34 millimeters of mercury. Quite substantially elevated. Now, at this point of time, Pramod, I would like to enter the aortic valve, if possible, and see a transmitral gradient. So can I have a termo wire? I'm going to exchange this into your Judkin's right coronary artery catheter to cross the aortic valve. Let me try my luck to see whether I am going to cross. Okay, so I will take a Judkin's right. If the Judkin's right fails, then I will take an Amplatz left. She has aortic stenosis as well, and the aortic valve I need to cross in order to get a transmitral gradient. This is a 6 French arterial sheath? 7 French, okay. So I should be able to get a good quality. Change it into aortic scales. I take it out. What is this? Okay, I want contrast so that I make a hand angiogram. This is spirit. Throw it out. Okay, so this is the doming aortic valve. I want to cross that doming aortic valve. Run this angiogram.
Because you are planning aortic balloon valvuloplasty also,
yes,
correct?
Yes, both.
What is your aortic valve annulus? Do you measure that by echo or do you confirm it with your angiogram when you get into LV?
No, it is done on echocardiogram. Echocardiogram, it measured 16, right, Pramod? 16 millimeter.
This might be a challenging part of the procedure, but you made it look easy.
Okay, now I want a pigtail catheter on the left ventricle. Pigtail on the left ventricle. She's getting a lot of ectopics because of my rigid wire, because of my termo wire that is lying in the. Did we give, after my septal puncture, did we give heparin? Given? Okay. Sure, just confirm that we gave heparin. 5,000 heparin. Given? 6,000 given. Okay. It's wonderful. So now I'm entering with my. It's quite high LA pressure, Pramod. You see that? It's such a tall LA pressure. Okay. Now I have simultaneous LA and LV pressures. To record the transmitral gradient, Can we balance both the transducers now? This is crucial step in the assessment. Balance both. Do you think we need to flush the transducers? No? Perfect. Okay. Now, get both in 50 scales. 50 scales at a large, yeah, very good. Very good.
So maybe we can see hemodynamic big screen.
Hemodynamic big screen now. Hemodynamic big screen now. Put the transmitral gradient. I think we, record it and put the transmitral gradient. Did we give a metoprolol 5 milligram IV? Given, okay. The heart rate was 140 and it has now come down to 112, right? Okay. Now the transmitral gradient is 28.5 millimeter, or almost 29 millimeters of mercury transmitral gradient. The left ventricular end diastolic pressure is quite low, despite the fact that the patient is having severe aortic stenosis. I would like now to, so this is freeze it, please. We cannot freeze, right, in the screen. Okay, see, unfortunately, the monitor where we can freeze, I cannot show you, and you have to see live. Now I will try to show the next hemodynamics. I'm going to show you LV and aorta simultaneous. So this is...
Yeah, I think you were about 60 across the aortic valve, right?
Yeah, I'm now going to show you. So this is LV and aorta. Change the pressure scale. Now I want the pigtail wire. Increase the speed. Increase it. Okay. So, yeah, as you said, Alison, no, I want with the lines. I want with the lines. Little reduce it. Okay. Yeah, as you said, it is somewhere around 60 millimeters of mercury, peak-to-peak pressure difference. So the next step that we are going to do, hold the catheter. The next step that we are going to do is, this is a standard INUI-like mitral valvuloplasty balloon. We have got a similar to INUI balloon, a balloon that is called as SIM, made by a Chinese company. So I'm going to show now the step-by-step, the whole procedure. So this is a pigtail wire that goes in, that's entering the left atrial appendage, which I don't want. This is the pigtail wire that coils within the left atrium. I'm just taking cine for this because I can replay. Show this, play this again. Play this again. Press. So this is the left atrial entry with the pigtail wire or the coil wire. And the next step is, we dilate the groin with a 14 French dilator. And the same dilator now dilates the interatrial septum also. So now I'm showing, this is the interatrial septal dilatation. The next step is balloon dilatation of the mitral valve. So the balloon now goes in. This is the balloon. I think I can show the balloon now. This is now 20. You have inflated to full? Okay. I'll show you the balloon.
Siva, can you tell to the audience who is not everyday expert in this, the characteristic of the Inove balloon, the sizing, the criteria to use, the different size, etc.? Just make it briefly.
I will show you. This is a latex balloon. Show the balloon. This is a latex balloon. Show the balloon alone. So this is a latex balloon with the fabric between two layers of latex. The fabric has been put in such a way that the threads are far apart in the distal part. So the distal always dilates first. Then the fabric threads are little closer in the proximal part. So the second part is the proximal. and the fabric threads are very close to each other in the middle part, that the middle part will dilate the last. So basically what we do is dilate the distal part, catch the narrow commissural region, then inflate the left atrial part, and then expand the whole balloon. The formula that we use is the height of the patient divided by 10, add with 10. This particular patient, let us assume, is 150 centimeter. I will divide by 10, that is 15, and then add a 10, so that means 25. So I will set the waist of this balloon to 25 millimeter. There is something called as a slenderizing tube that passes through this INUE balloon, and that makes the balloon get elongated. So we have the balloon fully elongated. So this is the fully elongated balloon, and this is 14 French. So at this point, I am taking it over the stainless steel wire. So the stainless steel wire supports this INUE balloon, and we are now crossing the groin. Take your hands up.
So is this the same size balloon that you used during her pregnancy or her previous dilation?
I think the previous time I dilated to 24 millimeters, cautious, a little bit low, because at that time I did not want to create a mitral regurgitation and jeopardize her pregnancy, but I wanted some amount of reduction of the transmitral gradients. So now I'm walking through the transeptal puncture dilatation that I have already done. Now 50% here, so what I'm doing is I am removing the slenderizing tube and advancing the balloon. So now the slenderizing tube has come out. Now I am shortening the balloon by the third step. There is a ratchet mechanism here, which I am slightly pulling out. So now I have pulled out this ratchet, and so now I have shortened the balloon. So now this is the balloon has been like, I have got the balloon within the left atrium. At this point, I aspirate, I flush it. This is saline, this is contrast. Take it out. I need the contrast in a 10 ml syringe. I am again connecting back to left atrium and left ventricular pressure to be sure that I am still within the left atrium. Very, very, very rarely we can have, after the transeptal puncture, when we are advancing the balloon, somewhere we perforate the anterior wall of the left atrium and the balloon walks into the transverse sinus, and still it will look like we are within the left atrial cavity. So now I am the hemodynamics are showing that I am still within the left atrium, and the left atrial pressure is almost around 30 millimeters. Now, I want to come to RAO view. Yeah, be ready. So in RAO view, what I do is, I'm taking the stillet. The stillet is a directable stillet. Can you zoom in on the stillet? So this is called as the J stillet. This is to direct the mitral valve, the balloon towards the mitral valve. So it has got a U-curve with an anterior tilt. I am now advancing this inside the mitral valve. And now I'm giving a counterclockwise torque to
make
the...
Can you see the screen?
Now show the fluoroscopy.
Yeah.
Okay. So now I am making it face towards the mitral valve. At this point, now I want to locate the mitral valve. So I'm going to do a left ventricular angiography. So that is the left ventricular angiography, a faint picture, but it gives me a landmark. Run it. You have loaded contrast. Maybe for the audience, it will be better to show it. Get a connector. I'll give a good quality LV angiogram so that you see it better.
Do you ever use transthoracic echo also during this, or just use your pigtail and your LV?
After the balloon dilatation, I will use both hemodynamic monitoring as well as transthoracic echocardiogram. We will do both. Right now, the angiogram that I did was good enough for me, but in order to get a good quality image, I am now connecting to regular injector, 25 ml at 15 rate. 25 ml, 15 rate. Ready? Okay. We are able to see that mitral valve. Can you freeze and transfer? Freeze. Okay. Freeze it when the valve is opening. Freeze when the valve is... now it is closed. Yeah. Yeah. Correct. No. The previous. Transfer.
Yes.
Okay. So here, I'm coming down on the... This septal puncture is catching my balloon, so let me see. Come to AP view once again.
Yes, there is a question for you from the audience. Yep. Go ahead.
Dr. Shiva, it's not a question. Something that we do in mitrals, usually it helps to inflate the balloon a little so that it never plops back. It locks it in the LA, just the distal part of the balloon a little bit so that we don't pull the whole thing out.
Sure. Who is this?
Where are you from?
I'm Georgie. I'm from Abu Dhabi.
Okay,
we've talked before.
Yeah, Georgie, sorry. Voice, I was not able to identify who was the person. Definitely. Actually, Georgie, what the problem that I'm facing now is the septal puncture is holding my balloon. So I will do that. Okay, this is what you wanted, right? We to do that. I wanted to get the... See, the septal puncture is holding my balloon. The balloon is, okay, now I have got it little bit released.
Now it appears as if you are free.
No, I have to get it anterior, Allison. The septal puncture area is holding it.
Yes.
Come to, okay, I'll
maybe
just
for the beginners, doing a septal, transeptal puncture under echo control could allow us to put
can you
better
elevo?
Puncture
elevo?
To facilitate the progression of the catheter in the left atrium to left ventricle, isn't it?
Yeah. Now, what I'm doing is I'm slightly inflating the interatrial septum. Okay. Now come back to Arevo. I slightly inflated the interatrial septum.
Your dilator went through very nicely without any perceived resistance. It looked like you had a lot of the distal balloon inflated in the left atrium. Do you think you got something in the septum to dilate?
Actually, I dilated with this balloon itself little bit.
Right, I'm just trying to see if it dilated enough in the septum or it just was the big distal balloon in the LA.
Can you get into LAO again? LAO? Nice
oh.
Elevo. Full elevo. Okay. That is the septum. Go more elevo, more elevo.
Okay. Yeah, I can't tell what's in the septum with the overlay.
Less elevo and more cranial. Cranial. Okay. Less elevo. Less elevo. I'm making a pop into the. Okay, now come to arevo. It's facing well the mitral valve. It has entered the mitral valve. I just need to. So now I have got the mitral valve. Okay, now I need pressures continuously. My pressures have fallen apart. Like, okay. Get me a flush. Show the aortic pressure.
Do you have your LV catheter transmitted now?
Yeah, that also I will get you both. LV, I disconnected it for the LV angiogram, but now I will reconnect it to pressure. Alison, how is Dr. Prasad, my colleague? Ex-colleague. Alison?
Yeah, now you have, do you have a radial catheter in or your other?
No, that is the sidearm of my sheath.
Gotcha.
I have a 7-French sheath with a 5-French pigtail, and now that is the left ventricle. Okay, now this is the LV, this is the aorta, and now I am going for the dilatation. So what we do here is, go on, this is arevo, right? Okay, I'm just inflating. Show that angiogram once again. Yep, run that angiogram. Run the angiogram. Yeah. So this is the angiogram. It's 30 degree RAO. I'm going back to the same 30 degree projection. Show me the angiogram once again. So I'm inflating my balloon. I'm pulling back to the mitral valve. And I am giving a full inflation. And I have deflated. Show that, fluorostore that, and show that again. Fluorostore, and then show that again. The balloon is actually going a little bit more subvalvar, but let me see what is my LA pressure now. So I'm disconnecting the aorta and connecting to the balloon. What was the previous LA pressure? It was 34, right? 34. Now, let us see what is it now. Let's wait for some time. It's somewhere around 25. Can somebody do an echocardiogram, apical four-chamber view?
Yeah, would you do a quick echo now for mitral regurg?
Increase the speed now. The pressures have come down from 34 to 25. Are you seeing the pressure tracing?
We can see, but not big.
Okay, make a hemodynamics big. So it's around 23. When the echo is going on, she's struggling, and so the LA pressure is slightly going up. But otherwise, it was coming to 23. Now make the echo big. Echo. Make it bigger. The mitral valve is opened to some extent. The tachycardia is persisting. Can you give another 5 milligram metoprolol? Can you?
How much do you accept mitral regurg?
Right now, is there a mitral regurgitation? Let me see. There is a mild mitral regurgitation now.
Well, you've got a balloon through it as well, isn't it?
The balloon is not across, Salim. A balloon, I have taken it out. There is nothing that is there. The balloon is only in the left atrium. There is definitely a mild mitral regurgitation. Zoom that mitral valve now. Make it wider. Reduce the gains.
Your posterior leaflet's moving better.
Yeah, slightly better. Yeah, previously it was totally immobile. Now, can you freeze it when the mitral valve is fully open and record the maximum dimension between the two leaflets? Just the amount of separation. Little bit more. Okay, that's around 10 millimeters. Let me have a look at the echo. Can you put the eye up? Yeah. Get me another glove. Show me. Okay. Now make the picture bigger on the zoom on the mitral valve. There is a fair amount of opening, though not fully. One more thing that I have to say that is the patient is having substantial tachycardia, possibly due to a lot of anxiety, because she's conscious. Make the picture brighter.
I mean, you have done a third mitral balloon valvuloplasty using the appropriate balloon in excellent position. So you have to accept the result that you have, I believe. You also have aortic valvuloplasty to perform, which should help her also.
Yeah. What I will do right now is, Alison, I will leave the mitral balloon fully flushed here. Pramod, can you get it flushed, the mitral balloon? I will go for the aortic. And after dilating the aortic, then let us see one full final hemodynamics and then take a call about whether I can inject another 1 ml extra into this mitral balloon and make it a little bit more larger. So right now, I will leave the mitral balloon in the same location.
Amal.
Yes, it's Amal again, Shiva from Egypt. I wanted to ask you, if you have the echo available, why didn't you guide when you were trying to enter the left ventricle with the balloon entangled in the septostomy? I mean, why didn't you use the echo as another form of guidance? I don't understand. What is your rationale?
For identifying that the resistance for me to push the balloon was at the level of atrial septum?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, why didn't you use the echo as well?
Amal, the only place where there can be a resistance for the mitral valvuloplasty balloon is only atrial septum, because I have entered from the inferior vena cava into the right atrium, into the left atrium, and I am trying to enter into the mitral valve, and as I am trying to advance the balloon is not moving. So the only place which I have penetrated and gone with the balloon is the septum. All the other areas are going to be roomy. So I know that it is going to be at the level of atrial septum.
Obviously very experienced.
And the strategy will be to dilate the atrial septum. So what we do is slightly pull back the balloon, get it to the level where again I get the resistance, and gently inflate. I don't know whether we have stored it. Can we see whether you have stored it? Go back. Yeah. This is the picture. Just run this. You see now, I am inflating in the left ventricle, the distal part. Just keep like observing. See, now I have deinflated. I have pulled it. Now I am inflating the right atrial part, little bit, not too much, because I don't want to create a large ASD. So a little bit of dilatation. The only place where there can be a resistance is atrial septum alone. Nowhere else there is going to be a resistance. Now, as I speak to you, the left atrial pressure is around 22 millimeters of mercury. It's slightly becoming better and better. And so at this moment, I'm going to go for aortic valve.
And how many times would you do balloon mitral valve stenosis in rheumatic without fearing of the mitral regurge?
We have done a maximum of about 4 times balloon mitral valvotomies in our clinical practice. But I do agree that the first result is the best result. The second will be little less. Third will be very suboptimal. Fourth will be extremely suboptimal. I do share your views that the results are not as good as the first time. In fact, this patient had as a juvenile mitral stenosis, which is defined as mitral stenosis occurring before 20 years of age. She presented at 12 years of age. So at 12 years of age, we possibly got the maximum chances of results, the best result. Then subsequently, it was during her pregnancy where we made a very cautious, guarded dilatation. We did not go for full-fledged balloon dilatation. I'm now advancing my aortic valvuloplasty balloon, which is a tie shack balloon.
So what size balloon do you have?
I'm matching 1:1. It's a 16, okay. Right, Pramod? Yeah, I'm matching 1:1, Alison. So can we see the angiogram of the aortic valve? So the aortic valve is on the left side of the spine. So this is a 16 millimeter tie shack balloon.
Siva, do you use rapid pacing during balloon dilation?
It's a good point. Actually, we quite often we use a rapid pacing. In this particular patient, if I have to use a rapid pacing, I have to have either another transvenous access, or I have to come out of my mitral balloon and then go for a pacing catheter. So I am actually planning not to go for a rapid pacing.
So can you place down the wire in the left ventricle, Siva?
I have not done it, Eric, so far. People have told quite often, I don't know which all parts of the wire has to be scratched to get the electrical current being passed on to the left ventricle. This is an amplet super stiff guide wire from the Boston Scientific, which has got some blue colored insulation running till the tip. The only place that is exposed is the other end here, which is exposed. All the other parts is this blue insulation. So whether I should have scratched the tip to make the electrical conduction, I don't know. So I have not done it. I have heard this people use the safari wire during a mitral transcatheter mitral valve in valve replacement to pace the left ventricle, but I have not done it so far. How will you do it if I have used this particular wire? This is the Boston Scientific blue colored amplet super stiff guide wire with a 6 centimeter floppy tip. Do you think the pacing will work?
Well, you'd also need an indifferent attached to her skin or something, and if she's awake, it'll be painful, so maybe okay. Not in an awake patient.
So as a trade-off, what I have done is, I have taken a long balloon so that it doesn't milk out, and I have positioned it now. I'm going for the inflation. Fluorostore this?
I did not really see any waste. Did you see a waste?
I didn't see either. Oh, it ruptured. Now, it was a hand inflation. It ruptured. Now what I'm going to do is take out and assess the hemodynamics now. I want the pigtail again. Show me that ruptured sequence. Yeah. Just keep running it. Yeah, so this was a tie shack balloon that ruptured. I'm going to put in the pigtail again and then see the pressures. The aortic pressure is looking good now, as there is not much of an anatrotic shoulder now, but let me have a look at the LV pressure as well.
The LA pressure went up a lot with that.
I didn't observe that. I was watching the fluoroscopy. So did you observe that LA pressure was quite high during the balloon dilatation?
Yeah, maybe it's just a delayed release.
It's a cross clamp of the aorta. It's
maybe like your echo can show us quickly the aortic valve.
Echo also. Come on the echo for the aortic valve? So now I have the LV and aorta pressure trace. Increase the speed. It's very nice result, Alison. Can you see that?
Make the, I do see that.
Make the echo big. Make the hemodynamics big. Hemodynamics big. So you see that the LV to aorta, we have actually nicely brought it down. I'm quite happy, Alison.
Yes,
do you see, I don't see AR right when you had the first color view there and your wire.
Can you make the echo bigger now? Echo big? Yeah. Yeah. Put the color. Alison, there is a mild AR, but I have a catheter across. I have to pull back the catheter. But this AR is very small, Alison. It's a very narrow jet.
Yes.
No, that's good.
Very tiny rigors, quite acceptable, no question, with a small gradient. I think they're very, very nice result, I would say.
Yeah. So now what I'm going to do is, again, check the mitral gradient to decide on whether I need to do something more on the mitral valve, or this result itself is acceptable, because the more you try to do and more harm you do, the patient will ultimately end up in mitral valve replacement surgery, which we actually wanted to avoid at the primary go. So
she has some mitral regurg now, so you have relieved the aortic stenosis,
and now
you should just see how she does.
Yeah. Now the left atrial pressure is around 20 millimeters of mercury. Put it on big screen, hemodynamics big screen. Put it on 25 scales. Yeah. See, now this is the LA pressure is around 20 now. It started with 34, and now we have come down to 20. The transmitral gradient, can you put it now? The previous transmitral gradient was around 28, no? 28. Now can we see 11? So
well, I think that's the overall is very nice result for both valves, and you should be very happy about that.
Yes.
I wonder if all the audience agree with that. Yes.
I will do one thing. I agree with you that not this one. I agree with you that I am not inclined to dilate any further. But since there was substantial pulmonary hypertension, I want the stillet. A substantial pulmonary hypertension previously, I want to see how much of, get the pigtail one. So I want to see how much we have relieved the PA pressures. So can you show the heart fluoroscopy? So now I am advancing my pigtail wire. It's going into the left atrial appendage. I will try to avoid it. Yeah, this is good. I'm locking my slenderizing tube. I am taking out this catheter. I want now that 9-French short sheath once again. This whole mitral valvuloplasty and aortic valvuloplasty is completely just a hemodynamic guided procedure. So what we do is primarily concentrate only on the pressure tracings. So we try to get the best possible pressure traces of the left ventricle and aorta, as well as left ventricle and the left atrium. And that guides the procedure. I want a right coronary artery catheter inside this. I'm now going to take a repeat hemodynamics in the pulmonary artery and the central aorta. Wire out. So now I have my catheter in the left atrium. Make the hemodynamics large. Hemodynamic screen large. So this is simultaneous LA and LV now. It's even better now. It's Now she's straining now. Oh, its catheter has gone into the left ventricle. So I'm going to take it out from the left ventricle into the left atrium. Yeah, this is left atrium now. So the left atrial pressure is about 16 to 17. Yeah, it is between 16 to 17. I'm coming down to the right atrium. This is now right atrium. Right atrium is around 12. Can you get me a wire? I want to get into the pulmonary artery. Fluorobic. Go and sit. So now pulmonary artery and aorta simultaneous. I'm going to make a pullback from the LV to aorta, put it on LV systolic scale. So I'm pulling back the LV from, let it be in the same scale, continue to run it. So there is a gradient of around 25 millimeters of mercury, 20 millimeters of mercury, and the pulmonary artery pressure has substantially fallen. What is the previous pulmonary artery pressure? 95 millimeters of mercury systolic to now almost 45 millimeters of mercury systolic. So that's almost
excellent.
50% reduction in the pulmonary artery systolic pressure. And can we see both together? The aortic pressure has marginally become higher. Previously, the aortic pressure was around 89 or 90 or something. Okay, 90. From 90, the aortic pressure is now increased to 110, whereas the pulmonary artery pressure has come down substantially, thereby giving us a very satisfactory result at the end of the procedure. So now, I think our transmission time is getting over. Do we have more time? We have another 5 minutes more.
We have one question for you about her medical regimen. Is she on beta blocker or
Okay.
Other?
Till now she was on injection benzathine penicillin, 12 lakhs units, once in 21 days. From the time I did the pregnancy balloon mitral valvotomy about 6 years ago. She will continue to be on it until she is 40 years, or if it is possible, I will continue her on injectable penicillin even after. She was on atenolol, a beta blocker, till now. I probably will look at the heart rate in the clinic tomorrow. Today she had a lot of tachycardia, possibly due to anxiety because we have not given her any big sedation. I had to give 2 doses of IV metoprolol to control her heart rate. Right now, as I speak, it is about 87 to 90. I will continue her possibly on a small dose of beta blocker. She will be continued on yearly follow-up with a small dose of beta blocker plus injection benzathine penicillin. And we will decide about when to change her aortic valve and mitral valve at a much later date. I would anticipate she will probably remain free of a surgical intervention for the mitral and aortic valve for at least another 5 years plus.
Outstanding result.
Thanks a lot. In another 15 minutes time, we are coming back again live on the same Congress Theater with yet another 4 interesting cases, of which 2 will be percutaneous pulmonary valves and 2 will be another very exciting cases that includes a sinus venosus defect covered stent exclusion. So we will say goodbye for now, but in another 15 minutes,
right,
we are again getting back.
Thank you
very
much.
Going to work all night.
Bye-bye. Thank you.